Hello everyone and welcome back. In the previous set of videos, we have talked about big data, the architecture of HDFS and MapReduce in detail as well. Before we go further and start working hands-on, let us quickly review what else is there in Hadoop. By reviewing what they call the ecosystem of Hadoop, we will get an idea of how all the components in Hadoop interact. In this video, that is exactly what we are going to do. Generally, when you have noticed that when people from the IT world, such as architects and developers, discuss software, they typically immediately qualify the software tool for its specific usage. For example, they may say that Apache Tomcat is a web server and that MySQL is a database. However, when it comes to Hadoop, things become a little bit more complicated. Hadoop encompasses a multiplicity of tools that are designed and implemented to work together. As a result, Hadoop can be used for many things, and consequently, people often define it based on the way they are using it. For some people, Hadoop is a data management system bringing together massive amounts of structured and unstructured data. For others, it could be a massively parallel execution framework bringing the power of supercomputing to the masses. Some view Hadoop as an open source community creating tools and software for solving big data problems, because Hadoop provides such a wide array of capabilities that can be adapted to solve many problems. So many consider it to be a basic framework. Certainly Hadoop provides all of these capabilities, but how? Because when Hadoop was released by Apache initially, it comprised its core components, namely HDFS and MapReduce. And with just HDFS and MapReduce, not all of the capabilities we talked about are possible. The reason is that Hadoop is not just HDFS and MapReduce anymore. Many self-standing software projects have come up around Hadoop, with each project addressing a variety of problem spaces and meeting different needs. All these projects, put together with the core components HDFS and MapReduce, are commonly referred to as the Hadoop ecosystem. The purpose of these projects range from data storage to data integration to data processing and to specialized tools for data analysts. Many of these projects were begun by the same people or companies who were the major developers and early users of Hadoop, while some others were initiated by commercial Hadoop distributors. The majority of these projects now share a home with Hadoop at the Apache Software Foundation, which supports open source software development and encourages the development of communities surrounding these projects. All these projects are not meant to all be used together. Some may even try to solve the same problem in many different ways. What unites them is that they each seek to tap into the scalability and power of Hadoop, particularly the HDFS component of Hadoop. Typically, there are five components that form an entire solution. They are data ingestion, data storage, data processing, data analysis, and finally we have management and monitoring. Now let us look at the various projects of the Hadoop's ecosystem that perform the above functions. For data storage, at the foundation level we have Hadoop Distributed File System, which is the core component of the Hadoop ecosystem. HDFS is the mechanism by which a large amount of data can be distributed over a cluster of nodes, and data that is written once will be read many times for analytics. It provides the foundation for other tools such as Pig, Hive, and HBase. Also, there is HBase, which is a column-oriented NoSQL database and is typically used for fast read-write access to large amounts of data. It is well suited for sparse datasets, which are common in many big data use cases. It is also used when you need random real-time read-write access to your big data. And unlike relational database systems, HBase does not support a structured query language like SQL. In fact, HBase isn't a relational data store at all. HBase applications are written in Java, much like a typical MapReduce application. HBase does support writing applications in Avro, REST, and Thrift. Now, once we have the data stored, Hadoop's main execution framework, MapReduce, is used for processing. And like we have seen, MapReduce is a programming model for distributed parallel data processing, breaking jobs into mapping phases and reduce phases. The framework takes care of scheduling tasks, monitoring them, and re-executing any failed tasks. Hadoop's MapReduce jobs typically run on distributed data stored in the HDFS, although it does run on data stored in HBase as well. And then we also have MapReduce 2.0, or YARN as they call it, which stands for Yet Another Resource Negotiator. Hadoop's original version of MapReduce supported a rudimentary job and task tracking system. But as the mix of work supported by Hadoop changed, the scheduler could not keep up, and this did not support the needs of many enterprises. So a new capability was designed to address these shortcomings that offer more flexibility, efficiency, and performance. For the purpose of data analysis, we have PIG, which is a high-level procedural language platform that provides abstraction over the complexity of MapReduce programming. The PIG platform includes an execution environment and a scripting language called PIGLatin used to analyze Hadoop datasets. Its compiler translates PIGLatin into sequences of MapReduce programs that run in a distributed manner. Another project that is also extensively used for data analysis is Hive. Hive is basically a data warehouse infrastructure built on top of Hadoop for providing data summarization, query, and analysis. Hive provides a mechanism to project structure onto data that is stored as files in HDFS and query the data using a SQL-like language called Hive Query Language. Having a SQL-like interface enables developers not familiar with MapReduce to write data queries that are internally translated into MapReduce jobs in Hadoop. And like PIG, Hive was developed as an abstraction layer, but geared more towards database analysts more familiar with SQL than Java programming. And then we also have Mahout, which is a machine learning and data mining library that provides MapReduce implementations for popular algorithms used for clustering, regression testing, and statistical modeling. Without having data in HDFS or HBase, we cannot perform any processing or analysis, isn't it? Typically, in an enterprise, this data will be locked in server logs or application logs or even databases. In order to be able to integrate Hadoop effectively with the rest of the enterprise, there are primarily two projects. Scoop is a connectivity tool for moving data between relational databases and data warehouses, while Flume is a distributed, reliable, and highly available service for efficiently collecting, aggregating, and moving large amounts of data from individual machines to HDFS. It is based on a simple and flexible architecture and provides a streaming of data flows. It leverages a simple, extensible data model, allowing you to move data from multiple machines within an enterprise into Hadoop. And finally, for the purposes of management and monitoring, we have a couple of projects as well. There is ZooKeeper, which is Hadoop's distributed coordination service that provides a centralized infrastructure and services that enable synchronization across a cluster. Designed to run over a cluster of machines, it is a highly scalable service used for management of Hadoop operations, and many components of Hadoop depend on it. And then there is Oozi, which is a scalable workflow system used to coordinate execution of multiple MapReduce jobs. It is capable of managing a significant amount of complexity, basing the execution on external events that include timing and presence of required data. This is not a complete picture because there are a lot of other related projects, but this is a good start to understanding how Hadoop's various projects provide functionalities that are required to build enterprise-class solutions. With that, we come to the end of this video. And in the next set of videos, we are going to go hands-on and set up a single-node Hadoop cluster. Thank you for watching and stay tuned.